Thank you, and good afternoon, everyone. I'm Judge Thomas, and together with Judge Liberti, I am very pleased to welcome you to the opening general session of our conference this year, Interpreting the Constitution, a Debate on Originalism and Its Alternatives. It won't come as news to any of you in this room that there has been an increasing amount of debate and discussion over the role of originalism in constitutional interpretation, and about the Supreme Court's direction to lower courts regarding the application of that methodology. But what is originalism? What are the various forms of originalist theory? What do critics of originalism say, and what alternatives do they offer? And not least importantly, what are the implications of the theory and its alternatives for all of us sitting in this room? Judge Liberti and I are so excited for what we know will be an extremely informative and engaging conversation between our panelists, one which will give us insights regarding these questions and more. I want to invite you all to please ask questions, write down questions on the index cards that are on your table, and raise your hand. They'll be collected, and we'll have plenty of time for questions and answers during the panel. I'm going to turn it to Judge Liberti to introduce our panelists.
Thank you, Judge Thomas. Good afternoon, everybody. Our three panelists up here today need no introduction. I'm sure they are all familiar to you. All of them are highly accomplished academics. They are recognized for their valuable contributions to constitutional interpretation and theory. Their work lines the bookshelves of judges, lawyers, and scholars. They have influenced legal thinking at the highest levels of the judiciary and at the bar. They are Professor David Strauss from the University of Chicago Law School, Professor John McGinnis from Northwestern University School of Law, and our moderator is Professor Akhil Reed Amar of the Yale Law School. I'd like to quickly thank the other two folks who helped us put this together. Joanna Scavone, who is the chair of our of the Ninth Circuit appellate, lawyer representatives, thank you. And Tyler Gilman, who is the circuit executive from the District of Montana. Judge Thomas?
And finally, before we get started, we'd like to extend a special thanks to Professor Amar for providing judicial attendees with copies of his book, The Words That Made Us. So judges, on the backs of your name tags, you'll see a little red slip. On your way out of the panel this afternoon, you can exchange it for a copy of the book. Professor Amar has already signed some copies of the book, and he has told us that he'd be pleased to sign other copies for you. He'll be outside after the panel this afternoon. So with that, Professor Amar, I turn it to you, and we're very excited for this conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge Thomas. Thank you, Judge Liberti. Thank you all, very distinguished audience members, for coming. This is styled as a debate, but it's really going to be a conversation. They say I get to be moderator, but I'm not the most moderate person in the world, so I'm going to jump in from time to time. We're going to talk. We disagree. And we're going to be candid with you about areas of agreement and disagreement. Just by way of a kind of introduction different than you're going to get in our formal bios, I would say my friend John McGinnis counts himself as an originalist, and he's often reckoned a political conservative. My friend David Strauss accounts himself as a critic of originalism, and he's often reckoned a political liberal. I see myself as an originalist and a political liberal. So two liberals, two originalists. We're going to have a conversation, as I said. Here's the first question that Judge Thomas actually teed up for us. What is originalism? How would you even begin to define it? Lisa Blatt, my friend earlier, said that 10 years ago she had never even heard of the word. I'll go first. I'm going to ask them very quickly in 2 minutes or so to define originalism for themselves and tell us, you know, whether they're for it or against it, although I've stolen their thunder just a little bit. I would describe originalism as a philosophy adhered to by someone, could be a judge or a citizen, another government official, who pays particular attention to the text of the Constitution, the written Constitution, its history and structure. So kind of text, history, and structure tends to prioritize those things, give them more emphasis on balance than, for example, the precedents that have accumulated over the years by the United States Supreme Court. So that's my definition, basically, of originalism. And its main alternative, I think, is a more precedent-focused account. We originalists believe in the amendments, and we disagree among ourselves, as well as the original document. Not everyone, and I think we originalists are liberals as well as conservatives, and the folks on the other side are political liberals as well as conservatives. So that might be my account. John, what's yours?
Well, I think I generally agree with your definition, Akhil. So let me add about why one might be an originalist. I think originalists think that the original meaning is binding. We don't necessarily oppose precedent, but why is it binding? Why, in a case of first impression, should it control? And even when we overrule precedents, which the court does from time to time, why is it overruled, and should it be overruled in light of the original meaning? I think it's there are two overriding reasons for it. And one is that we, the people, created this document in an act of popular sovereignty, and it's their words as they understood them, that were that act of popular sovereignty. And the second reason, I think, is this is not any act of popular sovereignty, it's a consensus act. It's a consensus act, there were consensus of Philadelphia Convention, and then the supermajority ratification process, and that's true of the amendments as well. It's a consensus-making process. And let me say, if we see in contemporary example of the problems without a consensus is, think, what's going on in Israel. In Israel, the Supreme Court essentially created its constitution without consensus, and now we have a majority that wants to, a narrow majority, wants to take it away, and that can really split a society down together. So our fundamental law really needs to come from a popular consensus, and that's one of the elements that makes for a good constitution.
David, you have a different view.
Yeah, I wouldn't presume to define originalism because I don't consider myself an originalist. But I would say on the views that Akhil and John expressed, I think on a day-to-day basis, litigated cases, controversial cases, litigated or not, the Constitution is not about the text, and it's not about the original understandings. It's about precedent, and precedent broadly conceived, not just Supreme Court decisions, but understandings we've arrived at about, for example, the scope of the federal government and other issues, that's what determines what the Constitution is, as I said, in litigated cases and day-to-day. That's not to say the text is irrelevant, very, very far from it. The text is critically important, but it tends to be important on things that are not controversial. When does the president leave office? I guess that's become controversial, but it didn't used to be. How many senators per state, things like that, that are terribly important, but not controversial. And as far as, you know, isn't the Constitution the will of the people, I'm going to cheat a little bit. I'm going to plagiarize and paraphrase Noah Webster, who was a contemporary of the framers, and a comment he made once about the drafting of a written Constitution. I'm going to adapt it to the present day. If someone came up to you and said, you know, you've got all these difficult constitutional issues about freedom of speech, freedom of religion, affirmative action, abortion, capital punishment, here's how we're going to resolve them. We're going to see what New Zealand does in resolving these issues. What do they think in New Zealand about these issues? And then we'll do whatever they do. You'd say, why should we do that? That doesn't make any sense. But we have a lot more in common with today's New Zealanders than we do with the 19th and the 18th and mid-19th century gentlemen who drafted the Constitution. So why are we listening metaphorically to them any more than we would listen to New Zealand? So that's why I think originalism, at least as it's commonly understood, is a very problematic view.
So I'm going to disagree with that, but let me actually first throw it back to you, because you used a certain word, irrelevant, And you said, well, you know, you don't think that it's all irrelevant, but there's a very famous article by a fellow named David Strauss, you might know him, on the irrelevance. This isn't the title.
Yeah, that's
the Harvard Law Review. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The irrelevance of the constitutional amendments. Mm-hmm. Now, for people like John and yours truly, them's fighting words. So say some more.
Oh yeah, I'm more than happy to talk about that. Here's a quick way into the thesis of that article. There's a current issue about the Equal Rights Amendment, guaranteeing equal rights. Equal rights under law should not be deprived by, may not be deprived by the United States or states on account of sex. Should it be added to the Constitution? It's not clear how much of a difference it will make if that's added to the Constitution. I think it should be added, but I think it should be added mostly for symbolic reasons. It'd be good to have that in the Constitution. Sort of like a national holiday is symbolically important. But it's very difficult to identify a way in which the law would actually change if that were added to the Constitution. And that is a more common story than you think. That by the time the Constitution is amended, when the Constitution is amended, either things have already changed, and the amendment ratifies a change that's already happened, as has happened to a significant degree, maybe not enough, but to a significant degree with the status of women in our society. Or if the amendment comes too soon, it's effectively nullified until society catches up with it, which was, for example, the 14th and 15th Amendments to a significant degree. So I think that, and then there's the whole range of changes in our government that have to be called constitutional that were not accompanied with an amendment. The expansion of the federal government's power, the expansion of the executive branch's power, the growth of the administrative state, the civil rights revolution was unaccompanied by a formal amendment. So you put all these things together, and my claim, I don't want to exaggerate because you're writing an academic article, but the amendment process is much less important than it appears to be, and the real mechanisms of change in our society are much more evolutionary.
You and I disagree with that. Why don't you go first?
Okay, well, I would say that the amendment process is central. The 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments were central to creating, as often said, a new birth of freedom, and in some sense, the failure of those amendments to be enforced are a tragedy of non-originalism. We wouldn't be, the civil rights process wouldn't have been necessary if actually they had followed the 15th Amendment on voting rights. And so I think in some sense, the amendments are the power of the amendments, I think, can be recognized by sometimes the failure of originalism to enforce them. I would also say that non-originalism is one way that kills the amendment process. So the Equal Rights Amendment, I think probably some of the decisions of the Supreme Court were not sound as an original matter on equal rights, but it took the winds out of the sail of the Equal Rights Amendment. It's one of the things that destroys the amendment process. Moreover, it came on the heels of a time when the court was very loose in its interpretation of the Constitution, and people lost confidence that if they wrote something and put it in the Constitution, that the court would actually follow its meaning. And that's sort of pretty black letter. It's pretty obvious that happens. If we have a court that doesn't interpret contracts according to their terms, we're going to have fewer contract laws. And so the originalism is very important to protecting the amendment process. So I think the amendment process has brought in very important things, the 16th, the 17th Amendment on income tax and direct election of senators, besides the civil rights amendments. But in the modern era, when originalism fell, I think, into less use, it's not surprising that the amendment process became less relevant, because there is an alternative. The non-originalism is an alternative to the amendment process. And if you think consensus of the people is so crucial to creating a constitution, it's not such a good alternative.
So I'm going to disagree with both of them, and then I'm going to switch the topic. And so you can think about the switch topic. Originalism is a different proposition when we're talking about the presidency or the Supreme Court than when we're talking about lower federal courts and state courts. So we're going to move to that. But here's where I disagree with my friend David. He said we have more in common with New Zealand than with George Washington and Abe Lincoln. I say, no. because presidents are still presidents and they're four-year terms. And when you're thinking about whether, for example, you can fire a cabinet officer at will, New Zealand is not going to help you at all on that. And the decision of 1789 is, and the Senate is still the Senate even after the 17th Amendment. So if you're actually doing this thing, what's the word I'm looking for? Oh, yes, it's called law. Actually, there's profound continuity. Every single president needs to know what Abe Lincoln did, what George Washington did for a lot of things that are called constitutional law. Maybe rights might be different in certain ways, but the idea that a system that's not based on federalism and separation of powers and bicameralism actually has more in common with America today just isn't true, I'm claiming, just descriptively, of the vast, just tons and tons of what we call constitutional law. You actually need to know that we have fixed elections, you see, and at 4 years, you have to leave, and that's not true in a snap election system, parliamentary system, and all the rest. So I disagree with my friend David about that. I disagree with my friend John. You see, we're gonna have a conversation here. Because he thinks, we agree that the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments are utterly transformative. The original Constitution is pro-slavery, you see, and our Constitution is profoundly anti-slavery, and the idea that those amendments were irrelevant is, I would say, one, just ridiculous, and two, offensive to the memories of these icons like Abraham Lincoln and Harriet Beecher Stowe and Frederick Douglass and Charles Sumner and the rest. And without 13 and 14 and 15, oh my God, we're a totally different society. So I'm with John with that, but I disagree. I'm with you in thinking ERA actually is largely symbolic because the 14th Amendment already says equal. It already says everyone born in America is born a citizen, born an equal citizen. We're all created equal, born equal. That's Lincoln's riff on Jefferson at Gettysburg. And it doesn't say race in the 14th, and it could. And the 15th does say race, color, previous condition of servitude. It's about a broader birth equality principle at the level at which the text itself is pitched and the history actually itself occurred. And I'm saying, oh, this is what I've done every day of my life for the past 35 years, is, you know, just study that history. It's about birth equality. It's about we're born equal, created equal, whether we're born black or white. Yes, that's the core case, but whether we're born male or female, or gay or straight, or in wedlock or out of wedlock, or firstborn or fifthborn in the family. That's the birth equality principle. And then the 19th Amendment adds to that for women. So I actually think 14th Amendment plus 19th Amendment, in fact, equals ERA. So on that one, an ERA might be irrelevant. I'm still for it for symbolic and other reasons. Gandhi was once asked, and then we're going to switch to lower courts, what he thought of Western civilization. And he said, I think it would be a good idea. I think there are a lot of things in the Constitution that are good ideas, we do, and the danger of non-originalism isn't just, is that the good ideas that people bled and died for, if you don't think that this actually means what it says, oh, you could add to it in good ways, or you could detract from it in bad ways. You know, and you could lose everything that actually people fought and died for if you say, oh, 200 years ago, what did they know about this or that or the other thing? Well, I think they knew a thing or two about the structure, which is the same, and they knew a thing or two about, you know, rights, and they said there could be more rights, but nevertheless, and I'd want to know what their core rights were and why, and that, my friends, is originalism. Now, here's the...
Before we get into inferior courts, I've got to answer some of that. I can't let you get the last word on that stuff, Akhil.
Okay. I thought I was the moderator.
Okay, let's talk about the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. The 14th Amendment has sex discrimination in it. Section 2 of the 14th Amendment contains sex discrimination. The leading feminists at the time opposed it because it contained sex discrimination.
Some did, some didn't.
Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony. Pretty hard-hitting people.
And you want me to go through? Because, dude, seriously, if we're actually going to talk about who's done the work on this, I can give you eight other names.
Fine,
and Section 2 was about political rights. And
yes.
Hold on.
Yes.
The words of The first sentence of the 14th Amendment and the second come directly from Elizabeth Cady Stanton. They do. They come from Seneca Falls Declaration and something that she wrote in January 1865. She's in favor of Section 1. She doesn't like Section 2, which is about voting and political rights and the 15th and the 19th Amendments.
She opposed ratification.
She absolutely did. And Lucretia Mott didn't, and Lucy Stone didn't, and it split the feminist movement. If you want.
Before we run it up the flagpole as a great feminist accomplishment, you have to acknowledge that.
And I promise you, because this is the question, how do you know? You have to look at scholars, because actually, judges can't do this on their own. So on this, I'll give you three things to read. A piece called Women in the Constitution. It's 8 pages. You could read it. And it says women split on it. A chapter that I wrote in a book called America's Constitution, a biography, that tells you actually this split the women's movement down to, in two. And here's what some folks said, and here's what other folks said. And the new one isn't out yet. It's called Born Equal. And actually, it begins with Elizabeth Cady Stanton in her own words on the day she gets married. And she's throughout the book. So I promise you, if you're going to do serious originalism, because I claim some of us have done it, what you just said is half of the truth.
Ooh, only half. At least I got half. That's something. That's better than usual, right? Those are all good things to read, but I think the thing you'd want to read is about the progression of the women's movement in the time since the 14th Amendment, mostly in the 20th century, and that's what got us to the place we are today.
Including the 19th.
Not an archaeological recovery of what was done at the time of the 14th Amendment.
But lower courts. Tell them about lower courts.
I want to talk about the 13th and 14th Amendments, too. Okay. The 14th Amendment was considered by a lot of people to be unnecessary. The Radical Republicans enacted the Civil Rights Act of 1866 without the 14th Amendment. Andrew Johnson vetoed it. They thought they needed to amend the Constitution because of constitutional objections. They thought the 13th Amendment got them where they needed to go. Now, that's controversial. But if that had prevailed, we might not have a 14th Amendment.
So the 14th Amendment, good. This is good. He's saying it's basically irrelevant. We're saying, what are you talking about?
I think we would have, and they thought it was unnecessary, but here's another data point for you. Racial discrimination is unconstitutional, not just if practiced by the states, but if practiced by the federal government. The 14th Amendment applies only to the states.
The first sentence of the 14th Amendment has no state action requirement whatsoever, and actually, John Marshall Harlan says this, that the elder in Plessy versus Ferguson in his dissent and 15 other people say it, the first sentence of the Civil Rights Act of 1866 applies to the federal territories. Everyone born in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof is a citizen of the United States, an equal citizen. We're born equal. We're created equal. That's true against the federal government. And Justice Thomas said that recently in two cases, didn't he?
So what I just want to say, I think the core of the 14th Amendment to make sure that to get rid of the black codes, I think would have gotten rid of black, the Jim Crow, and the equal voting rights in the 15th Amendment, if enforced, would be transformative.
Right.
So I just think it's very hard to say that those amendments were not transformative amendments.
They weren't enforced.
They weren't enforced, and that's the tragedy of non-originalism.
Yes.
Plessy is a non-originalist.
The people who didn't enforce
it
weren't saying we're not originalists. They just didn't enforce it because they were racists. That's why they didn't enforce it. And it started to be enforced when the country overcame its racism. That's when it started to be enforced, not when we all signed on to originalism. The things that drive progress on the Constitution are not these debates we're having. They're developments in society. And a lot of them are going to happen no matter what happens to the text of the Constitution, as we've seen with the equality of women, as we've seen with a bunch of other stuff.
Well, certainly it is true that it's important to have a structure of society that helps you enforce the amendments. That there's no doubt also that people talk about the amendments and they talk about the Constitution as a method of organizing their social movements. That was, of course, true before the Civil War. It's true throughout the civil rights era. It's absolutely crucial that they be able to appeal to these. I mean, it's not the case that everyone is a committed civil rights person. What allows people to persuade, I think, Americans in general, is that these are part of our constitutional tradition. That's an important component of their being able to persuade it. That's always, that's been true of American history throughout, that that social movements have always appealed to the past and to the, quote, the sacred documents of the past. So I think even on your account, it's very hard to dismiss these as irrelevancies.
I agree that they serve that function, and that I agree with that. But plenty of social movements have succeeded without appealing to the Constitution. The environmental movement, the labor movement, they don't appeal to constitutional.
But let's just on that, because here's the people that I claim, at least, and I hope John does, liberal. And then let's talk about lower courts, because we got a lot of lower court folks here. So I don't think originalism is intrinsically conservative at all. The Warren Court revolutionizes precedent in the name of, led by Hugo Black, in the name of claims about the text. This is actually Hugo Black's pocket constitution that I'm waving around here. Happened in the New Deal also, liberals overturning precedents, appealing to the text. But liberal originalism has a great tradition. Here are the icons, Abraham Lincoln. This is what 47 years is all about. MLK, in our lifetime, opening words of his mouth and the, what we call the I Have a Dream speech, are 50 years ago. And he's actually talking about, actually when you read the speech, promises were made in this document. That's what he says again and again. He's saying like Gandhi, you know, this it sounds like a good idea. You know, let's actually do. Martin Luther King, I promise when you read him, and you might say it's all window dressing, but he's making originalist arguments, and so too with Lincoln. There's more agreement. We agreed in advance we were going to try to give you a good show. But there's more agreement in that. What we say, which is at a minimum, the text actually is a focal point. It does organize. It's what we have in common as Americans in a very diverse society, because some of us, our families came over yesterday, and some 250 years ago, and some with bullwhips in their hand, and some in chains. The only thing that we have in common, those originalists think, there's the text of the Constitution, the story behind it, and we can all organize around it. That's not inconsistent with a big theme of your excellent book on the living Constitution, which is that the Constitution is a focal point for social coordination, social movements left and right, judges, people acting outside of the judiciary. You think precedent can be a focal point too, but we actually do agree that this it's not irrelevant, even if it just kind of only anchors. You tend to think that some of this is kind of soft, that people say it, but they don't really believe it. And I tend to think MLK thinks a lot about Abe Lincoln and the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment. It's deeper for him. But here's where I think you have a very powerful point. Lower federal courts, notwithstanding all of this, those of us who are originalists, we're not sure, some of us, that lower federal courts actually get to do this all the time. Lower federal courts, David has said earlier, and I agree with him on this, are really overwhelmingly focused on Supreme Court precedent. Now, I think we have an account of that, but why don't you say some more about lower federal courts?
Sure, I'll say something about that. I also want to get back to the role of the Constitution itself. I mean, I think the lower federal courts, and for that matter, the Supreme Court, you pick up a Supreme Court opinion or you listen to a Supreme Court argument, and they're talking mostly about their cases, as the lower courts are. They're talking about circuit precedent, they're talking about Supreme Court precedent, reading the cases very closely, just the way common law judges do. And that's what Supreme Court briefs consist of. And yes, you put in some history if you have it, and it's helpful to you, but a lot of it is focused on precedent, and a lot of the things that the justices, as well as lower court judges, are concerned about is, how does this fit with what we've said before in these cases? The other piece of it, which I think is something that is a concern of mine, one of my concerns about originalism, is the sort of the traditional common law approach to judging as precedent, plus sort of common sense notions of fairness and decency and good policy. And those are in the picture too. And they're in the picture in arguments in the Supreme Court, maybe to a lesser extent in lower courts, but certainly to some extent in lower courts. I think originalism forces people to put those arguments in the mouth of the framers. So instead of saying, look, here's a principle, it's consistent with precedent, it makes some sense, you've got to say, no, no, the framers gave this to us. And that's just not true. And if you think that, you know, the way to shape the law within the limited range that's given to you should be shaped this way because that makes more sense, or that's a fairer way to treat people, or that's a more sensible obligation to impose on law enforcement authorities or local governments, or any of these millions of policy type concerns that go into decisions, you should say that. You shouldn't say, well, I've dug in the letters of the framers and this was their understanding of the meaning of the word, because that's not what's really going on. Let me say a word about the invocation of the Constitution, because of course it's very powerful rhetorically, and we all do it. We all do it. It's a reflex almost to invoke the framers or invoke our constitutional history. But speaking of the sort of diverse origins of people, one thing that troubles me about originalism is I do think it is, I mean, I'm going to go a little far here. I think it is implicitly ethnocentric. I think it sort of conveys the message that we're all, you know, what's great about the framers is they were Americans. That's our tradition. They were our forefathers. That, I gotta say, when people talk about them as the founding fathers, that kind of bugs me. I mean, I don't know about your ancestors, but mine were in Philadelphia. They were somewhere in Central Europe running away from the armies of the Tsar. And our Constitution, we have to think about our Constitution in a way that we can talk about it to someone who says, look, I want to live here. I want to play by the rules. I think you have a great society. I think you have a great legal system. I don't buy into this idea that we're part of a multi-generational American family. My traditions are elsewhere. What do you have to say to me? And to that person, we have to say, here's why it makes sense to follow the Constitution. It's the product of generations of thought that have put these precedents and these traditions into practice. They seem to work pretty well, and they're good morally. That's the argument we make to him. Not, you know, back then, your ancestors said this. They weren't my ancestors. Why should that appeal to me? Unless I can say, and they were good ideas, and they've stuck around. And well, I think that's the way it ought to work.
So I'm going to jump in at a certain point, but he's made at least three, you know, big claims. I think at least couple of them are very powerful. I'm going to, you know, jump in at one point. But he said at least three things that you might want to address. One, and I agree with him, most justices, most of the time, not just, I'll do you one better, 95% of the time, they talk about precedent. So isn't that right? And how do you think about that? Second, lower court. I keep inviting you to talk more about lower courts, but you kind of, you know, but he's got such a strong point, maybe you wanted to use your time elsewhere. But lower court judges really follow Supreme Court precedent and don't rethink things de novo. What's your account of that? And then third, he said some stuff about ethnocentrism and all the rest. I've got some thoughts on that, but your turn.
Too. So why don't I begin with that and go round to the precedent issue. I mean, I think it's quite remarkable to talk about the fear that originalism leads to a kind of ethnocentric constitution. If you look at our constitution as compared to other constitutions in the world, it's quite a creedal constitution that has nothing to do with ethnicity, right? It's many constitutions say, well, you're part of our ethnic group, you can have a right of return here. That's not true of our constitution. Our constitution is a constitution for people, particularly after the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, with no ethnic restrictions. So I think it's a very odd argument. In fact, I would go even farther than that. I would say that one of the central facts of our Constitution, which is unique among all the constitutions of the world, is birthright citizenship. Well, birthright citizenship is the opposite of an ethnocentric constitution. And there are many people who think that birthright citizenship is a very foolish idea, and they make arguments based on the Constitution that it is a foolish idea, because they point out that there is this line in the Constitution, everyone's subject to the jurisdiction of the United States. And they make the sort of straightforward point that People who come to the United States and are not legally here are not subject to the jurisdiction of the United States, but originalists have rejected that. Originalists of all parties and an OLC of all parties have rejected that argument based on originalist arguments. And so I find that actually a strange argument, because I think one of the proudest aspects of our Constitution is how, unlike many other constitutions, is a constitution for people, at least now, of all races and ethnicities. Now, when we come to precedent, the easier question, I think, is why lower courts follow precedent. I think that's because the Constitution tells them, certainly it tells them to, if they're federal courts, because they're inferior courts, they should follow the Supreme Court's precedent. Now, I would say that doesn't mean there's no role for originalism. I mean, sometimes there are even issues of first impression in the lower courts and how to interpret Supreme Court precedent. You might think that you should consider the original Constitution as well in figuring out the scope of precedent. But even, you're quite right, that even at the Supreme Court, we talk a lot about precedent. I don't think that's wrong, because it's certainly, if the precedents are, and I think in general the Supreme Court does refer, at least in case of first impression, to the Constitution, and at least if they come from the Constitution, they're sort of shorthand, and the court has a party presentation rule that makes it sensible for us not to rethink things every time in every case, and so precedents are very sensible in that way. But ultimately, backstopping that, it's open to parties to ask for precedents to be overruled in light of the Constitution, and that's crucial, because we cannot have a common law constitution. The common law is great, I think, when we come to issues like tort law and contract law. It doesn't work in the constitutional setting, in the setting where we generally talk about the common law. They can be overruled by statute, and the amendment process is a lot harder than that. Moreover, the issues that are talked about, tort and contracts, they're important commercial issues that are not like abortion that can be a kind of issue that can split society in two. And finally, I don't think the common law addresses the big issue that it's supposed to be cracked up to address is social change. Common law precedents also look to the past. And when they run out, as you say, people have to make their judgments on common sense and fairness, but people disagree about common sense and fairness, particularly in these very controversial issues of social rights. So that's the reason that's not a good way to create a constitution. We want to create a constitution for consensus reasons, not for these reasons of not for bare majorities, and certainly not for a 5-4 Supreme Court majority of judges who are elite, who live in Washington. That's not a continental consensus that makes for the foundation of a fundamental law. So I think that's why the common law constitutionalism cannot be front and center, even if it makes some sense as a way of thinking about the Constitution, so long as we have the backstop of originalism always to correct it.
So we're going to move to a different set. I'm going to just try to put a pin in three points that have emerged. And the next set of questions are going to be about why, so you can be thinking about them. We're hearing so much more about originalism now than we might have, you know, what's going on with Dobbs and Bruin and some of these others. So just be ready for that. Here are my answers to these questions and points that have been made. So on lower courts, I think the simplest answer is when you look at the text, history, and structure of the Constitution itself, there are about four or five words that kind of swamp everything else if you're a lower court judge. You're a judge on a court that is described in the Constitution as inferior, twice, inferior to the Supreme Court. Article 1, Section 8 gives Congress the power to constitute inferiors, tribunal to, not just less than, but inferior to the Supreme Court. So it's supreme, that's a key word. You're on a court that is inferior to that. You know, the lieutenant generally follows what the general orders. So these are textual points, and they're structurally reinforced by rules of appellate review and reversal that go all the way back to the first Judiciary Act. And if you don't do that, you're going to get, you know, reversed. And I'm told that the Ninth Circuit has some experience with that. So that's why, in general, here's what I think the good originalist lower court judge does. Follow the Supreme Court, because that's what the Constitution, in fact, says in its text and its structure and its unbroken history. And in part two of the judicial opinion, if you're able to do it, it's a very hard job, and we all thank you for your service, because we know that you could be making a lot more money doing other things, and your spouses remind you of that every week at least. So we thank you for your service, and it's a really hard job. But if you, I was just talking to a judge, I'm not going to embarrass him, but he actually taught me something an hour ago about stuff that, something I never thought about before. If you've done research on something, in part two of the opinion, you can actually say, I've done this research with, you know, all due respect, you know, your lordships or whatever, you know, I think that this precedent, this line of precedence is erroneous and should be rethought. That'd be a really useful function for you to do. That's what we law professors try to do from time to time. But just to put a pin in it, lower court judges who are originalists default to precedent, because actually that's what the text and structure generally says. The Supreme Court itself, there are words in the, why are they so precedent focused? The words talk about judicial power, and precedent is part of judicial power. It structures the court as a continuous body, a body that by structural design pays attention to what it's done in the past, doesn't turn over continuously. Most justices most of the time do, and I think should do, as an originalist, precedent. The difference, and this is what we're going to start to talk about with Dobbs and Bruin and other cases, is we originalists tend to believe that when the precedents are believed in good faith by today's court to be clearly erroneous as an original matter, originalist matter, the precedents must yield. And precedent people actually think, no, that's too low a standard. So that's where the debate is. But most justices, most of the time, and rightly so, follow precedent. But even if 95% of the time you follow precedent, over many years, if 5% you're revising, and over, you do that over 20 or 30 or 40 years, it's going to make a difference. We're not meeting in Arizona. But let me tell you, since this is the Ninth Circuit, in the short run, stone beats water, and precedent wins day by day. But in the long run, in the very long run, just go to the Grand Canyon if you don't believe me, water will beat stone. And that's what we originalists believe. In the long run, even if you're only revisiting 5% of the issues over 20 or 30 years, that's a lot of revisiting. And that's what we're about to talk about. The final point. Since we talked about ethnocentrism, I just can't resist reading you a little bit from my hero, Mr. Lincoln. This is what he said, David, on just your point. 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth. Okay. And I say, fathers in what sense? Because he's addressing just your issue, and he's a liberal originalist, you see. Many in Lincoln's audience did not, and many Americans today do not, descend genetically from the men of 1776. When offering remarks about Independence Day in 1858, Lincoln pointedly noted that, quote, perhaps half our people are not descendants at all, unquote, of the Americans of 1776. Rather, this half, including, this is his quote, and it's a different America then, of course, but just hear his words, German, Irish, French, and Scandinavian folk, among others, have settled here, finding themselves, this is the key, our equals in all things. If they look back through history to trace their connection with those days of 1776 by blood, they find they have none, okay? But he said, Lincoln did, that what's happy, and this was what John and I believe, that because these principles proclaim these great texts, Declaration, Constitution, principles that transcend bloodlines, here's what Lincoln said. They involve, quote, a central moral principle, unquote, and that all subsequent generations, even those of us who don't descend by blood from them, are true children of 1776, here's Lincoln's phrase, as though they were blood of the blood and flesh of the flesh, unquote, of the founding fathers. So that, and if we are not originalists, we lose this ability to say, that's actually what they did say. We're all born equal, whether our parents are citizens or not. My parents weren't, you see, the day I'm born in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And we don't have a constitution defined ethnically by blood. And that's the text, history, and structure of an amendment that you are saying is irrelevant.
Okay, I've got to answer that.
And then...
What, you know what Lincoln did there?
Yes.
What he said was, when I talk about the fathers, I'm not talking about the actual people and what they actually thought. I'm turning them into an abstraction. I'm turning them into what we should believe. And I think that is the way to think about the framers. So here's the thought experiment. I've been asked the question sometimes, and you know, I do my non-originalist thing, people will say something like, well, if you were a framer, wouldn't you want everybody to be an originalist and follow what you did? And the answer is no, but think about it this way. Supposing we were all here drafting a constitution, and someone said, you're gonna want future generations to kind of look carefully at what you decided, right? And follow it. So pay a lot of attention to what you're deciding on all these issues, because they're going to govern the society for a long time until it gets amended by a very cumbersome process. I think our proper response would be, don't do that. We can't do that. We can't set the course for a society with specificity for generations. No one can do that. That would be supremely arrogant. What we can give you is some general principles and then tell you, you know, go work with them. Go make the best of them in the society that you have. But we're just giving you the starting point. And that's the way we should think of the framers. We should think, you know, what could they have given us? Well, they've given us some general principles that are pretty good principles, principles of equality and toleration, at a very high level of abstraction. They weren't all that egalitarian, and in some ways they weren't all that tolerant. But they gave us those principles at a very high level of abstraction, and we have taken them and worked with them and develop them down through the generations. And I think that's what Lincoln's saying. Yeah, we're not talking about the people who were your blood fathers. We are talking about the people who gave you the key ideas of our society. Now, if that's the way, if that's what originalism is, if it's here are some central ideas, some central, pretty abstract, but really important ideas, take them and develop them. Take them in directions that the actual flesh and blood people could never have anticipated, probably would have been a little bit horrified if they had anticipated. If that's what originalism is, I'm fine with that. But that doesn't decide cases. That leaves us the job, current generations the job, of implementing those principles.
So
and we're not going to get the answers by looking back at what they said.
So I'm going to, you guys get the next two words, but just, this is a perfect segue, David. Thank you for that. Two questions that we were asked to address, because I want to at least address the questions that we were told to. You're going to jump in soon enough. Okay, why are we hearing so much about originalism now? People want to know. Dobbs, Bruin, and concretely, you know, what's a poor appellate judge to do, a poor district judge to do, a master magistrate, or a lawyer, you know, to do with all this originalism stuff today? What would your counsel be? What would your counsel be? And I'll start with David, but then you can also, you know, respond to his last provocation.
Okay. Start with John. I've been babbling too much.
Okay.
Okay. So I think it's important to understand that the framers were very conscious that the world was going to change. Hamilton talks in the Federalist Papers about that, says we only should put things of permanent concern in the Constitution. And they built a good Constitution, which I think comes through a consensus-making process, necessarily has a lot of ways of creating change. One of its most important ways, for instance, is there are two important ways beside the amendment process. One is federalism, so a lot of the questions about having new rights for a new society, for changing technology, can be addressed because states can create new rights. And actually, we've seen this before. Something like Griswold, which of course is often thought to be an important decision, of course, this would have come in due course, both through the sexual revolution. What really drove the sexual revolution is not various U cases from the Supreme Court, I think not even ultimately same-sex marriages, But people using their First Amendment rights to write and make good points about it, and then for states to show that these experiments in living could work. And so that's in itself a huge way of creating social change in the Constitution, federalism, and so and then we have another way, which is that there are principles in the Constitution that are attempt to capture social change, even if commerce doesn't mean different things. As we have more commerce, that actually grows the power of the federal government just because of it.
Because there are more trains, planes, automobiles, there's more stuff that really is interstate.
There really becomes more stuff that's interstate. And so I think it's very important to understand that the Constitution is all about having a structure for change. It's not the way that we have to actually think about what they thought about how to deal with various problems, because it's a good constitution. They allowed us to address these various problems. And so I think that's, downplayed sometimes in living constitutionalism. We have a constitution, even though its terms don't change, that's all about creating a structure for the living, to be sure, because we'll do better if we have a consensus framework that we think is likely to be a good framework around which this consensus works. We could have, of course, have a parliamentary democracy. I think the United States has done pretty well compared to a lot of the parliamentary democracies in the world, a lot of better than ones without rights. We could imagine that.
I promise I'm going to come back to you, but I want you, now that you've had some time, you know, and we gave John a chance, the questions that we haven't addressed that we were asked, and when judges ask questions, it's, you know, we're supposed to answer them, you know, just like the lawyers at oral argument. Why, and you have a different account, I think, than John. Why are we hearing so much about originalism now? And go for it. Tell us what you really think. You haven't held back, and I'm grateful for that. And what's a poor litigant, lawyer, lower court judge to do? Because they can't be. And this is an important critique of originalism. How are they to actually, you know, do it if the Supreme Court, you know, wants them to do it? How is that going to work for a lower court judge? So your thoughts on this.
So let me do the first the why now, and then I'll talk a little bit about.
And then, John, your answer.
I think unhelpfully about how to sort of navigate the allegedly originalist world we're in now, if you're a litigator or a lower court judge. But why now? Here, the dirty secret of originalism is that it is a radical's creed. Radical means changing things in a fundamental way, not necessarily left to right, but changing things in a fundamental way. So here's why I say that. If you think the tradition you are currently in is bad, you've been handed a tradition, you've been handed precedents, you've been handed customs and cases and institutions, and you think they're corrupt or bad, and you want to attack them, how can you attack them? Where do you stand? The tradition is against you. So what do? You say, that's a corruption of the original principles. Let's go back to the founding principles and get rid of all this stuff that's been built up that is no good. It is the Protestant Reformation.
Martin Luther.
It's Martin Luther. And that's why you see originalism sometimes being embraced by liberals and sometimes being embraced by conservatives. So Justice Black, whom Akhil mentioned quite eloquently, maybe the most important originalist of the last 100 years, really, was a liberal.
I agree.
He was a liberal. His tradition was Jim Crow and Lochner, restrictions on the federal government. He hated both of those. Mm-hmm. So what did he do? He got out his little pocket constitution, and he said, that's not in here. Mm-hmm. The current wave of originalists are conservatives because they didn't like the Warren Court and they didn't like certain aspects of the Burger Court, especially Roe against Wade. Mm-hmm. So that was their tradition, and they didn't like it. They thought it was corrupt. Mm-hmm. So they needed a place to stand, so they say, mm-hmm. And also, I guess, the expansion of the federal government is a piece of this. No, mm-hmm. This is inconsistent with the founding principles. Mm-hmm. But notice what's going on there is you're defining the founding principles in a way that gives you leverage. Mm-hmm. You're attributing to the framers positions that you think are right and are generally consistent in some abstract way with what the framers said. Mm-hmm. And that's why we see outbursts of originalism.
Great.
When
so,
people are attacking something.
So I'm going to come back to him. What are courts supposed to do?
Right.
But John, just let's get back and forth here. Your thought on why now, why Dobbs, why Bruin, Carson, what have you?
So I certainly agree that often the Constitution is used to attack some current corrupt tradition. I agree with that. But I do think there's two other points that should be made. First of all, you have to agree that the Constitution is good. And that's not obvious. You have to actually accept that, or it's not going to be a very plausible argument to say that we should go back to the original Constitution. So there's something—
As amended.
Yes. And so that's a very important aspect of originalism. I think that also explains why there was the growth of originalism began in the 1980s. It becomes, I think, at a time when we actually want to, people start to argue that we have a good society, a good inheritance. And I think a lot of the debate today actually is about that, of whether we have a good constitution. And many people, I think, do think we do not have a good constitution. We do not have a fundamentally good society, or a society that progresses from sound principles. So I think that's front and center. I think there's one other aspect to
it. John, just on that. Since you mentioned Martin Luther, Martin Luther King, of course, is connected to that. And and Lincoln thinks that Dred Scott is corrupt because the Constitution permits Congress to prohibit slavery in the territories. Dred Scott says otherwise. And Lincoln, playing the role of liberal originalist, saying this is corrupt, you're corrupt. The texts in history actually completely support Congress's power to prohibit slavery in the territories. But you just said one thing, you used the word progress. Here's an interesting point, and then I do want to, because they want to know what they're supposed to do, and we haven't given them lots of guidance. They need to hire historians or not, so we're going to need to talk about that. Here's one very interesting thing you see about the amendments. If the game is comparing the amendments to, let's say, the precedents, I would say the precedents have ebbed and flowed over the years. There have been good ones and bad ones. I would say, with one exception, Prohibition, which was repealed, the amendments have actually gotten better and better. They've made amends for the lapses and the sins of the founding fathers. That's an if true. It's like someone was, said about Christianity, important if true. Okay, so if what I just said is true, that actually adding a Bill of Rights wasn't irrelevant, it was an improvement. These transformative Reconstruction amendments, 13, 14, 15, the Progressive Era amendments, woman suffrage, direct election of senators, the 1960s amendments, getting rid of poll tax disenfranchisement, constitutionalizing a right of 18-year-olds to vote in every state, that these amendments have actually made amends. They've made improvement. They've actually made progress in a way that I actually don't think can be said of precedents, which are 5-4, rulings from time to time by, elites, sometimes liberal, sometimes conservative, in Washington, D.C., quite clueless. The only consistency, basically, is that they'll always reverse the Ninth Circuit, but apart from that, okay. So what are they supposed to do? Can they become historic? And this is an argument for your side, David. Just because I think it's easier just to follow precedents than, and I think that's what they're in fact supposed to do as lower court judges, than to do originalist scholarship.
Yeah.
Your thoughts?
Yeah.
Your thoughts.
Well, I guess first one thought on the arc of progress in the Constitution. I mean, I agree the amendments have been movements for the most part in a good direction. So has the precedent. The law built on precedent, been movements in a good direction. If you look at the progress of racial equality, sex equality, LGBT rights, freedom of expression.
It's ebbed and flowed much more. You don't think that this court is better than the Warren Court.
Of course ebbs and flows, but the overall arc has been a good one. And of course the amendments, the interpretation of the amendments has ebbed and flowed. But on the question of what lower court judges should do, this actually gets to something else that, I mean, I said before that one thing that troubles me about originalism, I think it kind of forces people not to be fully candid if they're originalist, because they can't ever really say, I understand I'm operating within the boundaries of the law, and that can be kind of narrow, but there's room there, and I'm choosing this course because it just makes more sense. You can't say that. You got to attribute it to a framer. That's one problem. The other difficulty that I think originalism presents is that it suggests that there are kind of answers out there, and we just have to find the right way to look at the historical materials and find answers. And I think, you know, there's a question about, do, should judges be hiring historians to do, give expert testimony? I actually think that would be a bad idea, because it suggests that, you know, this is like something where an expert in a field can give you an answer. And my advice would be, do law. Just do law. And what law consists of is looking at these past practices, looking at these precedents, looking at traditions, and harmonizing them. Look at the original materials, see, have they developed? Have they caught on in the way that, you know, Marbury and McCulloch caught on, but some other early decisions did not? Have some of the original decisions caught on and developed and have come to us in a form that we want to accept or not? So to do that, just do that with everything. And I don't think it's that different. One thing that's troubling about, I don't know if it's an originalist decision, John, I think, thinks it is not an originalist decision, but Bruin, the New York State case about gun control, one thing that's troubling about that is just this tendency to kind of pretend that the answers are clear when they're not, and not to acknowledge that there's room for judgment, and there's room for deciding what makes sense. And that would be my advice. Just keep doing law. Keep doing law. Don't let them kind of get to you by saying, oh, you've got to go back and look at the original understandings. I have a friend in D.C. who's a very prominent D.C. lawyer, and we were talking about an oral argument in a case. And he said, now, is that one of the cases where they decided to do originalism, or are they just kind of doing what they always do? And he said, you know, I think when they grant a case, they should sort of say, now, in this case, we want to hear about originalism. Because sometimes they do, and sometimes they don't. And you know, the lawyers will get up and they'll talk about the Virginia Constitution, they'll talk about Blackstone, and they'll talk about various other folks, and the questions will be about precedent, the questions will be about common sense. And I think the originalism is very often kind of window dressing, rhetorical form. You throw some stuff in there from the founding, but what you're basically doing is precedent and common sense.
So I in some sense, agree with Professor Strauss on this. I think what originalists are doing is law. I don't think it is so different from what lawyers do all the time, in this sense, that when we look at a meaning of a statute, we have to go and look, unearth of what's going on about the statute. We look at the meaning of a contract. We look at the time of the contract formation, even if it's a long time ago. So we are collecting this evidence, and it's lawyers who are expert at this, not historians. Historians actually don't talk a lot about the meaning of documents. They talk about the motives of things. And so it makes absolute sense to look for the legal craft. But of course, that has to be informed by historical incidents, the historical context. And it's true that it's somewhat harder the longer it goes in the past. But I think courts today are much helped by what I would call a culture of originalism that's going on in the law schools. There are originalists of all sorts of ideological stripes who write all sorts of articles that actually are, I think, are very useful in helping us understand the original meaning of the Constitution. So I don't think what is necessary is to appoint experts. The point is to look at what is going on in the legal network of scholarship, and of course there are debates there, but of course that's also what judges and lawyers often do with all kinds of things. So it is the case that there's going to be disagreement about what the original meaning of a provision means, but there's disagreement throughout law. This is not anything fundamentally different. It's not the case that because there's disagreement, that means the meaning of the Constitution is necessarily indeterminate. There are better or worse meanings, and we have a process for finding that out that I don't think is extremely different with respect to originalism or the original meaning of provisions and the other things we do in law. To be sure, I think judges need more help in this respect, but a culture of originalism, which I think follows necessarily from the Supreme Court starting to become interested in originalism, it actually calls forth a whole group of helpers throughout the academy. And lawyers use this in their brief. So I'm much more optimistic about the ability of lawyers to take this information. One of the great things about being a lawyer is how eclectic lawyers are, how they're able to use all sorts of kinds of information to argue about meaning. And I think this is just they will certainly meet this call as they've met others.
So we're getting some questions here. If I had one friendly amendment or addition to what my friend John said, he said, you know, he said a couple things that I agree with lots of what's been said, but we academics do have a useful function to serve if we do our jobs right. I think, can and should try to be helpful to the judiciary. Your jobs are very, very hard, and you can use all the help you can get. Now, there are great projects, academic projects, about thinking about the cases in particular. I think of the Supreme Court Review out of the University of Chicago, edited by my friend David, and others. What John has said is there also are beginning to emerge scholars who meet with each other, talk to each other, of, he says, different ideological persuasions, who call themselves originalists. And he said they're generating articles that may be useful to you. My friendly amendment is not just articles, but books. And I say that, look, this book is a gift to you. It's out of my pocket. And thanks for, you know, everything that you do. And I think it counts as sufficiently de minimis that it doesn't need to be reported on some ethics form. Just saying. Amicus briefs. See, when lawyers are hiring experts, they have an agenda, an axe to grind. And I agree with John that historians are, in fact, not necessarily good on the law. They don't even understand that the originalism is actually not a theory of history, it's a theory of law. Amicus briefs, I think, can be helpful, and you can call for them if you you can also reach out to academics. I don't think it's improperly ex parte to ask an academic if something is already out there in the public domain on this issue or that one. Okay, that's because if it's out there in the public domain, if it's already been a published book or article, you're allowed as a judge to say, what could I read up on this topic that would help me get up to speed? And many of times this wouldn't have been produced in contemplation of this case or that one. It wouldn't be, you know, paid for by one side or the other. And our job then is actually to try not to be ideological about the thing, but to try to be straight. Because if we're ideological, we're not actually helping you, and we're not being true to originalism, which isn't supposed to be a theory of politics. I'll give you one example, and then we're going to take your questions. One of the bigger cases this term, I believe, was a case about the independent state legislature doctrine. It's called Moore versus Harper. I think originalism won the case. There's lots of precedent. The precedent's aligned with originalism here. There was an amicus brief filed by three scholars in particular. I was one of them. Vic Amar, who's appeared here, was another one. And the third was Steve Calabresi, the founder of the Federalist Society, the national chair of the Federalist Society. He's a Republican. He's conservative. Vic and I are Democrats and on the liberal side. And we agreed, you see, on what actually the history did show based on scholarship that some of us had done over many years. We were trying to be helpful to the Supreme Court. We'd like to be helpful to you all, too. So if we can be resources to just even tell you what's out there in the literature, or say, gee, you know, are you able or can you recommend people who might be able to write us an amicus brief on this or that or the other thing who aren't being paid by or picked by the parties? I think this could be a useful contribution on our part. Okay, I'm going to try to get through all these because you're judges, and you judges are, you know, like to have your questions answered. How to square any theory of originalism with the Supreme Court's Second Amendment decisions in Heller and Bruin? So I know, David, you're particularly interested in Second Amendment stuff, so you want to take the first crack?
Yeah, I don't claim any expertise about
and
that.
And there's several, so that I'm not going to read each one out loud, but there's several on the Second Amendment.
I mean, Heller purports to be thoroughgoing originalism. Heller was a case that said there's an individual right to bear arms in the Second Amendment. Bruin, it's not clear whether that's an originalist case or not. I think I mentioned earlier, I think John thinks it is not, but obviously he can speak for himself. But here's what I think is what those cases reveal about this issue that we're talking about. At the time of Heller, there had never been a case until the lower court case in Heller that actually held that there was an original right to bear arms, there was an individual right to bear arms in the Second Amendment. Now, there are lots of people who got put in jail for possessing firearms. But all that time, all those people convicted of firearms offenses sitting in jail, either no lawyer argued or no judge considered accepting the argument that that violated the person's constitutional rights. Heller came along and said, well, if you read the Second Amendment the right way and you dig into the history, there is an individual right. It was utterly inconsistent with what went before. Whether it overruled precedents is a little less clear. But as far as what the understanding was the Second Amendment does not establish an individual right. Chief Justice Berger, no softy, called the argument the Second Amendment establishes an individual right a fraud perpetrated on the American people. So that was the state of the tradition when Heller came down. Heller was directly in contradiction to that tradition, even if it didn't overrule any cases. Now Bruin comes along, and now they have to apply this individual right. So they came up with this weird hybrid in which they said, well, the first question is it within the Second Amendment? If it is within the Second Amendment, that's not the end of the story. Why not exactly? And if you're an originalist, you can still enforce the law against someone who possesses a firearm if you can show that there is a tradition of outlawing this kind of conduct. So it's this weird hybrid of the text says something, but the text can be overridden by tradition. This opens up all kinds of, I mean, not only is it, I think, internally inconsistent, either you go with the text and claim the text is going to answer your problems. If the text doesn't answer your problems, that's because the text doesn't answer your problems and you got to look elsewhere. Or you say this is all about precedent and tradition. And I think it's put lower court judges in this very difficult position of trying to figure out, well, okay, what counts as a tradition of outlawing this kind of conduct? I mean, are felon in possession laws like the laws that forbade dangerous people from having firearms that have existed for a long time? Puts lower court judges in an extremely difficult position, precisely because the court wanted to be originalist, then discovered it couldn't really be originalist, so it brought in this hybrid originalism and tradition.
Okay, we have lots of questions. I'm going to do my best. We're going to do lightning round answers.
Sure.
All three of us will try. Okay. Couple of questions about whether the framers themselves were originalist. My answer, yes, absolutely, and indeed, all the way up to Lincoln. Almost every president is not just originalist, but arguably the best originalist at the moment in America, and that's because they're ridiculously proud of what they've accomplished. That's why people like Lincoln are talking about the framers, the fathers, and all the rest, because they put the thing to a vote up and down a continent, and no one had ever done that in the history of planet Earth. So they were originalists, and proudly so. I'm talking about Alexander Hamilton and John Marshall and Abraham Lincoln and George Washington. They didn't always agree in application, but yes.
Can I just add to that? I think it's also important to say that they had judicial review because they were originalists. Before that, Blackstone said that judicial review would be subversive of all government because it would be judges looking at the hodgepodge of constitutional traditions in England and striking things down. But because of this act of popular sovereignty, that's what justified judicial review. And of course, that's what Hamilton says in Federalist 78 that justifies judicial review. So I think it's very hard to separate out judicial review from originalism. I think it's like trying to separate out the dancer from the dance, at least historically.
Okay.
I don't agree with any of that, but we can move on.
Wasn't Dworkin an originalist because he thought that the Constitution should be interpreted with reference to the morality that informed the original text? I think if that's originalism, anything is, it's a very high level of generality.
Yeah, I mean, there's some moves that originalists make, or people who want to portray themselves as originalists make, and one is to raise the level of abstraction. So, for example, when presented with evidence that the 14th Amendment was not thought to outlaw segregation in public facilities and certainly was not thought to give a right to interracial marriage, that was a third rail at the time. They say, well, you're misdescribing the original understanding. The original understanding was about racial equality. Now, once you get to racial equality, then we can apply that. And okay, if that's what you're going to do, then I think originalism is no different from what non-originalists believe. And that's, I think, what's going on in Dworkin's case.
So I would call it a kind of abstract fallacy. What originalists really do is they go and they try to figure out what's the appropriate level of generality with evidence from the time. What actually do people meant about equality and the Equal Protection Clause? That might be a distinction between Professor Amar and me with respect to women. But that's the kind of question that originalists need to answer. You can't assume an abstraction. It's often the case when you actually look at the words in the context of their time, they're not as abstract as they might strike a modern reader.
Speaking of which, one person asks, why, since you mentioned women's rights, why are three men talking about women's rights? I'm not sure we have a good answer. Touche, point well taken. Unless either of you has a better answer. Okay,
well, I'm
lightning round, remember. Okay. I think we just have to...
I think it's a big confusion in our society to think about identity and argument. I think actually, I disagree with the premise of that question, as unpopular as I'm sure it is among the audience. It's crucial to distinguish the strength of an argument from the identity of who makes it.
Okay. More honestly, I was asked to put the panel together. And so mea culpa, but I actually, to John's point, since he actually, I tried to pick the two people who I actually thought I'd learned the most from and who disagreed. There are other people I could have picked, but to John's point, I actually thought, you deserve the people who've written the most on this, and we need more people writing. I think we need more people in the academy and all the rest, but that's the honest answer, so blame me. They just said yes when invited, and thank you. A couple of questions here about textualism versus intent versus legislative history, statute versus constitution. Remember, lightning round. You first.
Well, I'm not quite sure what the question is.
Discuss. The Holy Roman Empire was neither Holy nor Roman nor an empire.
Well,
discuss.
So I'll just say that ultimately I think the right way to interpret statutes is the same way as the way to interpret constitutions. Textualism, I think, should be a form of what's called statutory originalism, understanding the text as it was by those who as it was understood at the time it was enacted. So I don't see a big difference between textualism as I understand it and originalism in the Constitution.
I mean, I can give you a list of places. This is what would open up a whole new conversation. But I think we actually depart from the text of the Constitution a lot. I can give you a list of ways, provisions of the Constitution that we've just blown past. Congress shall make no law, the First Amendment begins. Does that mean Joe Biden can discriminate against people because of their religious views or abridge their freedom of expression when he's exercising inherent executive powers or implementing a law of Congress? The Fourth Amendment protects the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects. To cell phone conversations, persons, no. Houses, no. Papers, that's exactly what they're not. Effects, no. What I said before about the Equal Protection Clause applying to the federal government. The 14th Amendment, the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment quite clearly does not reach voting. Lots of evidence for that. So property qualifications, disqualifying LGBT people from voting, constitutional.
Republican form of government, 15th Amendment.
Well, you can see, I'll say something about that in a second. And the other one, which take a look at the 21st Amendment sometimes, which says that if states want, it doesn't say this literally, but try to tell me why it's not an implication. If states want to say that racial minorities cannot have liquor licenses, they can do that. The 21st Amendment actually says that. Now, of course, the court says, no, that's not what's going on there. But here's what's going on. What's going on, it's perfectly fine, is we've arrived at certain understandings about how things should be through reasons other than the text, and then we read them back into the text. So we've kind of forgotten that the First Amendment begins with Congress because we know what the principle of freedom of expression means. We don't care that the 14th Amendment doesn't reach voting because we know there's got to be equality in voting rights. We don't care that the Equal Protection Clause applies only to the states because we know the federal government can't discriminate on the basis of race. We've learned these things in other ways. We've learned these things because the nature of the Constitution and what it requires evolves, and then we take that evolution and we jam it back into the provisions of the Constitution. And I think that's fine. I think that's the way things should work, but that is the way things work.
So one question, another one about the Second Amendment. I'm just going through them as fast as I can, and it's, you know, why doesn't my 19-year-old daughter have a right to own a machine gun today and be part of a well-armed militia? One deep method point, it's my lightning round, and then I'll let you on in on the next one, is actually, if you really want to think seriously about arms in America, it's not just the Second Amendment, it's the 14th Amendment and the Freedmen's Bureau and actually state constitutions and unenumerated rights. You have to actually think about at least the 14th Amendment and other things, and the Second Amendment gets changed, gets amended in all sorts of ways, and that's serious originalism. And the court highlights that actually in Bruin, and truthfully, you know, cards on the table, I'm cited at just that point for just this question about whether serious originalists need to think about 1868, which is because we're talking about cases about states and localities, Second Amendment being incorporated or applied against the states, and not just 1791. Justice Barrett goes out of order to say that's a really important question going forward. That's partly the answer to the question about machine guns and militias and all the rest, because the Civil War changed how we think about militias, and the amendments did too.
I think the purpose of protecting your safety doesn't necessarily go to machine guns. You have to distinguish between what's an appropriate regulation and an infringement on the right, and I think that's a perfectly, I mean, sometimes it's a hard line to draw, but I think it's implicit in the purpose of the Second Amendment. So I think there are answers to why machine guns may not be permitted under the Second Amendment.
So we've got 6 minutes left. I'm really going to try to, and I'll try to shut up now. A couple of questions on whether we think, you all think, the justices are, in their originalism, are actually serious. You know, is this a pose? I gave you my answer, which is in the most important case last term that could have actually handed the presidential election to the Republican Party and Donald Trump, Republican-dominated court in Moore versus Harper, rejected an aggressive right-wing ISL theory and did so partly because the precedents were against it, but very much in an opinion that also emphasized originalism based in part on amicus briefs by liberal and conservative scholars who came together. But your views on whether you think it's mainly a pose, and you don't.
I wouldn't want to attribute bad faith to anybody. I think what is going on is people's views about the Constitution are conditioned by the system we have, by the precedent we've built up. And when they go back and look at the original understandings, they see it through those eyes. So even if they were going to try to figure out the original understanding of the First Amendment, which is pretty complicated if you think that those guys wrote the Alien and Sedition Acts, several of them. It's pretty complicated. They will not be able to get out of their heads what we have learned over the years about freedom of expression, and that's fine. That's the way things should be. So I don't think it's bad faith. I think it's a matter of being so immersed in what we actually have, which is not an originalist system, that when they talk about originalism, it's already infused with that. And so I don't think it's bad faith. I think it is, you know, I think that they are doing what they think is originalism, but it is unavoidably captured by what the system has become, which is not originalist.
Well, I don't think that we have a difference there, though, between precedent. I think we could ask the same question, are judges following precedent in good faith? I think there's always that question. Are judges going to follow any methodology in good faith? Now, there are some famous examples of where it seems, from Gorsuch, from Scalia, from Thomas, that they do not follow their ideological priors. I'm sure that's true of some liberal justices who follow precedent as well. So I'm very cautious about saying anyone's acting in bad faith. Here again, I think we have an area of agreement here, but I don't think that's the reason either to be favor precedent or favor originalism. In my view, the issue really is what makes for a better constitution. Where do you think a better constitution is likely to be created, through a constitution-making process dominated by a consensus-making or through precedent? That, to me, is the crucial difference.
I'm not sure we're going to be able to do all of them. We've got 3 minutes left, but let me take actually a couple of the most provocative. Right? Let me just take the two biggest ones, and I have, and some of them were very, very specific, and I think we did talk about some of them, even if we didn't judge whoever you are with the greatest of respect, Your Honor. Even if we didn't, you know, quote your question, we actually did discuss the issues you raised, and sometimes you may have written it before we got to a point. Here are two. So, about overruling precedents. When the Supreme Court doesn't follow precedents, in the Supreme Court undermining due process by eliminating notice of the law. And I would say, of course not. Erie overrules Swift. Brown overrules Plessy. It can't be the case. You know, Barnett overrules Gabaitis. 1937 overruled tons of cases. So did the Warren Court. None of us believe that there's a general, I just want to see if this is true, due process problem with overruling precedents. We may disagree about what the proper standard is, mm-hmm. but there is, of course, a proper role for overruling precedents, and the precedents themselves say so. No, question mark? Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's a note of agreement. Okay, this is a good.
Can I just add one idea about
that? Just get along.
So one idea of even getting around some of these problems is to think about overruling precedent prospectively, right? So we can put the Constitution on the right path and still protect reliance interests. And I think that's an idea that actually the Warren Court had that may be a sound idea and one that we may see more discussion of as we try to struggle. I think the big question now is how do we deal with originalism and precedent altogether, not only about due process in a particular case, but without changing and having an upheaval in society. And so I think one prediction I have is that we'll start thinking more about perspective over ruling.
We're down to 1 minute. On that, for those of you, I'm pro-choice, personally, my brother clerked for Harry Blackmun, but if Dobbs came as a big surprise to you, you haven't been paying attention because the court, and at least many of the justices, and one of our two major parties has for a long time been putting us on notice that if they have 5 votes, this day will come. So you can say lots of things, but I don't think you can say it's a bolt from the blue. And David has written about how he doesn't like bolts from the blue in common law adjudication. Here's the last question, and I think we're going to get 3 different answers to this, which is why I'm picking this last question. How do originalists make room in the Constitution for LGBTQ+ people, rights of women just in general, okay? So I'll let you two go and then I'll weigh in as well. You're more skeptical about some of these. I think you very much believe them, but on non-originalist grounds, I believe in these things on originalist grounds. But John, why don't you go first, then David, then I'll wrap up. And we may be 30 seconds over, but no more than that. I know that red light is on, but.
Well, as someone who's generally sympathetic to these rights, I think these rights come through the political process. I think these rights come through federalism, through people having ideas and persuading people in their states to change these, and then states actually putting pressure on other states and the course of society. And I actually think with these matters, we'd move very quickly to the same result, and we'd move to the result in a way that I think people would feel that they weren't left out of the decision-making process, and that I think is very important in a society. I think we see the dangers of a society in which even a minority of people feel that they haven't been heard, and that can actually leave them I think vulnerable to all sorts of kinds of demagoguery. So I think a consensus-making process, which doesn't necessarily have to be through the amendment process, it can go state by state, is part of the genius of our Constitution in keeping us together.
Thank you for that last word.
I agree with a lot of what John said, that it is better, other things equal, to have these changes not come about through judicial decisions, but through democratic processes. The thing is, other things aren't equal. And while the democratic process is working itself out, you have people who are living their lives and they're being deprived. If you think that the current constitutional rules are wrong, they're being deprived of their constitutional rights to marry the person of their choice or to have an abortion in the previous generation. So that's on the other side of the ledger. And I think those are, you know, the both have to be taken into account. And I think it's often a genuine dilemma. And I respect people who say, as the Chief Justice did in the same-sex marriage case, it would be better for society if we just allowed this process to go forward state by state. I respect that. I don't agree with it because I think it's too important. The right is too important to allow people to continue to have it be denied. Now, the question was about originalism, and just let me sort of say, I think this is the kind of, and not John did not do this, but I think it is the kind of dodge originalists sometimes say. They kind of do the levels of abstraction thing. And they say, well, of course, it's not as if concretely the people who wrote the 14th Amendment thought they were establishing a right to same-sex marriage. They didn't even think they were establishing a right to interracial marriage, let alone same-sex marriage. But if you reinterpret the amendment to embrace ideas of equality, then you get to same-sex marriage. You know, you can do that if you want. But that's not what's really going on. What's really going on is a process in which same-sex marriage became increasingly accepted, and we think it's right. And those two things, the evolution of the law and the evolution of the law in a direction that we think is right, that's what really determines the content of the Constitution, not anything that can be credibly called originalism.
Thank you for that last word. Mine on this, and here we're, and then I know we're a little bit over, is at the level of generality at which the text of the 14th Amendment, because we're talking about not the founding, but these transformative amendments, the level of generality at which the text is written. They don't say race, and they could have. The 15th Amendment says race, color, previous condition of servitude. They said everyone is born a citizen. That is, born an equal citizen, born a full and equal citizen. We're all born equal. This is originalism, broadly understood. We're created equal. This was Lincoln's generation's amendment, constitutionalizing his vision, created equal, born equal. They could have said race and didn't, and they meant to capture race as a core case. But that means born equal, male and female, and Susan, forget Susan B. Anthony, she's not as relevant here, but Elizabeth Cady Stanton thought just that. 400,000 women petitioned, actually, at the time of the 14th Amendment. If you want lots of history, read Nina Morais's note in the Yale Law Journal on sex discrimination in the 14th Amendment, Lost History. Read Sandy Ryerson's piece in the Duke Women's Law Journal, not on the panel, those are, so, what about LGBT? And then you have the 19th Amendment. I think 14 plus 19 equals ERA, and I'm not fiddling with the level of generality. I'm talking about the level at which they pitched it, which is not opticians are equal to optometrists, not Williamson versus Leah, birth equality. Now you can see why they didn't actually understand same-sex marriage, and we do, because they didn't think. Just like they didn't have trains, planes, and automobiles, and now you do, same commerce clause, it means something different when you have more interstate commerce. We now believe that people are born this way. You know, if you're with Gaga, and I am, people are born this way, then that means if straights can marry, and they were born a certain way, then gays can marry. Okay, and you can understand why they didn't apply it that way, because they didn't actually have the concept of people being born a certain way. They didn't live in a world where Patrick could become Patricia, and Patricia could become Patrick. That wasn't their world. That actually is our world today, just like trains, planes, and automobiles. You see, that's an originalist argument. And I don't think he thinks I've maybe pumped up the level of generality.
Oh, yes. Oh,
okay.
Yes, you have.
But I say...
And I agree with him here.
Right. Correct. And I say, with all due respect, I could be wrong, but I spent a lot of time studying the history. I really have. And I haven't. And I'm trying to be attentive to the level at which the text itself is written. And we've given you some resources, scholarly resources, so you can read these pieces, articles, and books by lots of us, and judge for yourselves. And we are very grateful that you've invited us.
Thank you. Thank you.